Welcome back to our next episode of Tattoos, Code, and Data Flows. Very excited. I want everybody to see that we take our own medicine here at Bionic, and we decided to have our CTO and co-founder, Eyal Mamo, on the podcast. So you can actually see the backstory of Bionic. Very excited. Thank you for coming.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Well, welcome everybody. We're back for another episode of Tattoos, Code, and Data Flows. With me is my boss, CTO and co-founder of Bionic, and a really smart guy, but I don't have to talk about him. I'm going to let him talk about himself. Eyal, introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit of background, a little bit about yourself.
Good thing. Thanks for having me.
So, obviously,
I'm Eyal Mamo, CTO and co-founder here in Bionic. Kind of the background that I always love to tell about myself, computer geek since I've ever known myself, coding since I remember anything. I was recruited to 8200, which is the Israeli equivalent of the NSA. It was about 12 years ago, even a little bit more than that right now. I spent a total of 6 years almost over there doing cybersecurity-related research and development. Afterwards, spent a couple of years in startups in the cybersecurity space, up to eventually starting Bionic 2.5 years ago together with my co-founder Idan, to really start nailing in and understand a little better the challenges that organizations are having with their applications as they're moving to the cloud, as they're moving to agile and faster development and faster cycles, and kind of lose the control around those apps.
Oh, very good. Awesome. And, you know, we've worked very closely since I joined Bionic a little while ago, and you're definitely knowledgeable about the space, and really excited to have you on and kind of give the audience a new perspective, you know, a coworker from with Bionic from a different, more technical background. With that, we're going to move into our first section.
I'm thinking out loud.
Thank you, Mr. Ed Sheeran. Eyal, this first section is really, what do you think about when you get up in the morning? What is top of mind for you on a day-to-day basis as CTO and co-founder of Bionic? What are the things that really, you know, excite you, get you going, and really, you know, spend most of your days and most of your time doing?
Good question. So I think it changed, it evolved and changed, obviously, over time in Bionic. But in the end of the day, especially now, as Bionic is kind of at the stage where we're, you know, we're growing, we're working more and more with more and more and more customers, and we're exploding call it this way. What really gets me excited is like really to see our customers every day, working with Bionic, getting value out of it, and really, you know, imagining and start thinking of use cases and capabilities that none of us have ever imagined. In the end of the day, this is what really gets me excited. That together with working with the team in Bionic, I guess.
Awesome. And from a technical standpoint, what's like the cool tech aspect? You know, it could be Bionic specific or industry specific. What are the things you're thinking about in terms of, you know, security, risk, application architectures? What are the things that really get you going in terms of technology these days?
I would say a couple of things. Like in the end of the day, when me and Idan, we started Bionic, we really saw this gaping hole around applications and how they evolve and how they changed. And the fact that code is the only remaining and unmastered asset out there for organizations. And this really got me and Idan really quickly thinking, like, together with ourselves, like, what's going on? What's going on here? Like, the world was able to kind of capture the cloud and how it changes and how it changes over time. Network, obviously, long ago, we've been through that. But apps, what's so complicated about apps? And in the end of the day, what's so complicated about apps is it's the fact that this is unstructured data, as opposed to any other asset that you try to govern out there. And the worst thing about this asset is that people actually manufacture it and change it all the time. So you have unstructured, changing, morphing into different type of unstructured data day after day. The thought about how can we take this unstructured data, turn it into something structured that we can make decisions on top and drive value and control risk over on top is really what drove us. And kind of Idan, both of us coming out of a strong background, you can call it, I guess, low-level development, compiler engineering, and so on. That was exactly the type of challenge that we really loved kind of looking at and pushing forward. And this is what's really exciting in the technology that Bionic is doing in the end of the day.
Oh, awesome stuff. Awesome stuff. So we'll move into our next section.
I got a lot of problems with you people. Now you're going to hear about it.
So you got to have things that tick you off on a day-to-day basis. You got probably got a lot of things going on with your role at Bionic and growing a company. But, you know, what are the things in the industry that really bug you the most? This is your opportunity to stand on your soapbox and say, I don't like this, and I really want it to change in this way. So what is your rant for the day today?
Oh, man. I can go for days, but I'll pick my battles. I guess what really bugs me in the end of the day is kind of seeing an industry that is built around automation and doing things scalably, and seeing it actually going through horribly manual processes in order to do basic governance and basic control processes over what developers are doing within those organizations. One of the beautiful things that we're doing in Bionic is creating, obviously, those tools that would allow people to govern and do all that stuff. But there, it requires a lot of a change of state of mind for people to do, kind of shift their mind around, like, we can do it differently. We can do it other way around. And, you know, it both bugs me and both makes me excited. Because I know that once, like, people kind of figure out we can do that differently and they understand that, that's like a force multiplier for us as a company. But that deeply bugs me every day.
No, I totally get it. I'm on board with you with just the concept of, you know, automation being not totally automated and a little bit cumbersome to be totally honest. But, you know, on the opposite end of the spectrum, our next section really allows you to say, give your kind of your spin on how to make this perfect. So this is the Nirvana World section. You just had your rant session where you said, this is the problem. If you were given, you know, magic beans or a magic wand to basically cast your spell on it, the industry, technology as a whole, and making it a perfect or Nirvana world, what would that be? What would that look like for you?
So a Nirvana world, in the end of the day, would allow every developer, every security architect, every DevOps and platform engineer out there to just with a click of a button, get this this picture of what's the intent of my program, what it should do, what it should never do, and overlay on top of it, call it the boundaries that applications should be well within, and being able to rationalize it. So it's still far off from what Bionic is doing, because intent is hard. Like, programs, applications have a lot of inputs and outputs. They have close ties and relationship with infrastructure and operating systems and a lot more. So, like, I always kind of imagine that as kind of a minority report type of system that kind of really allows you, show me that VPC. What's going on there? What it should really do? This one is talking to a third party. This one, it's not encrypting its communications. Okay, amazing. Show me that. Let me solve that. Allow me now to actually move that one step forward and even remediate it without having to go through the standard change procedure cycles. Obviously, that would be Nirvana to me, at least.
Yeah, it's kind of one of the things I like to say is a lot of times people and organizations don't know what they don't know about their applications, how they work, how they're changing. And what you're really saying is you're allowing people to know the things that they don't know. It's, you got to know everything about it holistically and not have to guess at things anymore. Is that a correct statement?
That's a correct statement. And I think it's even further than that. Like, allow me to really understand what is a good state. Like, what are the best practices that this application should adhere to, given its intent? I hope that makes sense.
No, it absolutely does. And I think it's very valuable for people, because a lot of times we're going at this whole concept of risk and security without full bits of information. We're trying to, you know, fight a fire and we don't even know the source of the fire. And having that full kind of record of truth really allows us to be much more effective in mitigating, you know, risk or compliance or so on and so forth.
Right.
So now we're moving on to the fun section. This is the speed round, and I have my questions here ready to go. Again, there's no right or wrong answer. This is your opinion, and it's just meant to kind of, you know, kind of pique some interest, pique some conversation, and maybe a little controversy for the audience out there. First question, do you believe the correct term or the appropriate term is DevOps or DevSecOps? Are they the same? Are they different? Which is more important than the other one? Let me know your thoughts.
So I think DevSecOps is part of DevOps. We just underappreciated it. What basically DevOps says? DevOps says, like, take the SDLC and start automating it. And as part of the SDLC, you also have your security procedures, your security controls, your whatever it would be that allows you to really, your guardrails that allow you to keep your application in state. So for me, DevSecOps is just a subset of DevOps in the end of the day, and it's part of this democratizing, you can call it, security that we're seeing in the past couple of years.
No, I agree with you. It's interesting, though, because people are very passionate about this conversation. I posted out to LinkedIn asking this question, and there was people ready to just strangle each other over whether it was DevOps or DevSecOps. And it's amazing to me something so simple can be so controversial. We have our next question. Who do you respect most in the AppSec or development or just technological industry as a whole? Do you have somebody you look up to that you like to read their articles or, you know, just follow them on social media? Who is somebody you look up to in the world of tech?
For application security, obviously that would be OWASP. Like in the end of the day, there's a lot of great volunteers out there and people that are working very hard in order to keep this program up to date and expand it over time. And it's really incredible to see kind of this from the outside, kind of pushing forward. What really excites me and a lot of the background that I was coming from previously was around security research. This has always been a very exciting area with a lot of new stuff popping up every day. Kind of got really, really big in the past 5 years. And kind of looking back at where it was like 10 years ago when it was just a bunch of nobodies in the middle of nowhere, and then becoming this huge industry and company sponsoring security research at scale, such as, you know, called Google Project Zero and a lot of others. That's been really exciting and really allowed the industry to move forward from, I guess, communicate back to the rest of the industry those specific weaknesses and the issues, and made it a lot more educated, if that makes sense.
No, it totally does. And, you know, my career, I've been in application security for many, many years. I didn't have as much gray in my beard when I started. And the compliment you gave to OWASP, I think, is great, because it's been there every step of my journey in my professional career with application security with different companies. And the only consistent thing that's been there every step of the way has been the OWASP as an organization, the OWASP Top 10 for application security. And it's constantly a benchmark and kind of thought-provoking for many, many companies. So definitely, you're the first one to say that. So I think that's really cool.
I think that what's really cool about and what's really interesting to me is how it's evolving also over time and kind of understanding more and more that it needs to expand outside the classical application security kind of mythology. And it very connects to a lot of conversations that you and me had in the past, how everything is morphing kind of together from application security to cloud security. And becoming very complementary to each other. And so I find that really exciting.
Very cool. Next question. We got a couple more. Do you feel, and this is something I'm passionate about, people hear me talk about this all the time, do you feel shift left or the concept of shift left is still a thing, or is it different? I mean, what's your take on the term? Everyone uses it, but what's your take on shift left?
It's a very important concept that needs to be needs to kind of be embedded wherever possible. On the other hand, I do find it many times overestimated. Not in the sense that, like, whether I can or whether should I shift left if I can shift left. Like, if you can, like, please ahead, do that. Like, It will save you time. It will make a lot of things easier. It's more of the questions, what can't I shift left? Or how do I mitigate the fact that I cannot entirely shift that, concept, a specific concept or a specific issue left? Because in the end of the day, shift left is about saving cycles. Every stage that you move forward within the pipeline, within the SDLC, obviously, would make it a lot harder to fix as you move forward in that stage. But there are a lot of questions that are harder to answer without the fuller context of production or staging or whatever it would be. And being able to move production closer left in that sense, or taking the left pieces of the CICD and make them closer to production, is what we should really be focusing about, as opposed to shift everything left, in my opinion.
Makes perfect sense. So last question, and we can't have this as a promotion for Bionic, but what do you feel is the hottest new technology out there? And this could be a consumer technology, this could be a AppSec or architectural or a DevOps technology. Again, let's not talk about Bionic because we're both very passionate about that. But what do you think?
Not talking about that.
Okay, good. I don't want to think this is an ad for Bionic. But what do you think the hottest technology is out there? Something that you think is really cool?
Yeah, something that I think is really cool. I think that eBPF technology, that kind of and its applications that came up in the past, that are starting to come up in the past year or two, are really exciting because they're able to kind of really shift and change the landscape of both how monitoring tools and security tools are working in production over time. And we're starting to see more and more and more kind of commercial applications of eBPF coming out there. And I'm really excited to kind of see where it will go eventually. But it's what kind of one of those infrastructure utilities that over time, I think, kind of years from now, will enable many different lines of products over time with its lightweight observability capabilities that it really allows. And what's the most interesting about it, that like the day that eBPF became more and more and more widespread and installed across and enabled across more and more environments the past 3-4 years, it really made a lot of existing tools obsolete. And existing companies and products in many senses, and their core technology obsolete, and democratized the observability capabilities for production workloads, call it this way.
Awesome. Just so everybody knows, I mean, could you define the acronym for everybody, just if they want to do more research?
Sure. So eBPF is Enhanced Berkeley Packet Filters. The idea behind it is not really related specifically to packets or anything like that, but basically it allows you to set tracing across the running Linux system and actually codify those traces. And so you can build it like new applications right now that do functionality like application performance monitoring tools doing with instrumentations of code, just using those built-in capabilities of that Linux kernel is offering. On the other hand, it also allows you to build a lot of security tools out there that are dependent on tracing and observability of running workloads on top of a running system.
Awesome. Thank you for that, because people are probably going to be out there, Googling what the acronym means and everything. I just want to make sure everybody is up to date. So thank you for that. That's the end of the speed round. It was a little longer this time, but it's great. That's what we want from the speed round, is kind of new and interesting ideas and concepts.
That's a good way of saying I'm talking a lot.
No, you're doing a great job. Next section is up.
Your Honor, I move to disqualify Ms. Vito as an expert witness.
Can you answer the question?
No, it is a trick question.
So the trick questions are coming. Just kidding. So, a lot of the audience, we a lot of times we get into deep technical stuff, but we have a very big audience for Tattoos, Code, and Data Flows. And one of the things that, I'd like to ask you and just get your opinion on is, what would you change? You're the co-founder of a startup company that's doing very well. What do you know now that you wish you could go back and tell yourself in the beginning of this journey that you're on in terms of growing the company and everything? What have you learned and would like to go back to tell your newbie self that just started the company or is just starting to define the concept of the company?
So I'll start with a lot of things, but if I have to pick only one of them, I think it was another thing. I'm sure it was one of our early investors said to that we consulted a lot with during our time up to now. One of the things he told both me and Idan is think about the report that your customers want to see, that you want to give your customers in the end of the day, and build back from that. And you do a lot of exercises that kind of mimic that, but I've never really gotten the full sense of it until, I guess, a year ago, when we've started like doing really working with more and more and more customers, doing more POCs, and starting moving forward with the larger deployments. Because in the end of the day, he was trying to tell us, focus on the customer, what he sees at the end value, like, and what he does with that report. In the end of the day, more than anything, and it's something that you always constantly think about, you constantly rationalize, you constantly keep in your head. But I think I didn't really understand the full extent of it, of how important that is and how transformational that notion can be for the product development, for shortening cycles around that and more. So if I'll kind of sum it up, it's a good exercise that makes you think again and again and again and again, what value am I creating for my customer and how we can act on top of that value.
Oh, that's awesome. And, you know, one more question for you. I mean, what's the biggest surprise with growing a startup company in the technology space? You know, what's the biggest eye-opening thing you've had? You're like, oh my gosh, I didn't know this. What would that be for you?
I'll answer that a little differently, and maybe we'll cut it in the end. But if not, that that would be cool as well. But what's really eye-opening for me and what's really exciting for me is seeing the fact that kind of Bionic grows to be something that is bigger than me and Idan. Like things are like incredible features, incredible capabilities, incredible processes are starting to. Starting to become like without us even being involved, only kind of seeing like them growing in the end of the day, and kind of seeing that is really, I don't know if the word is eye opening, but really exciting to me in that sense.
Yeah. So probably what you're getting at, and this is the goal of any company, I think, is for their company name to become a verb. You know, it's like if you say you need to Bionic that application, you know, Google that, or, you know, Xerox that. When your company's name becomes a verb, I think you become bigger than yourself. Do you agree?
Yeah, definitely. Still not there, but one day.
it's a big thing to get, but I think that's the goal of any company, is for their company name to be considered a verb. Right. The last section.
Now he's getting a tattoo. Yeah, he's getting ink done. He asked for a 13, but they drew a 31.
So it's Tattoos, Code, and Data Flow. So I have to ask every guest that comes on, doesn't matter if they're my boss or not my boss or an industry expert. Yeah, Tattoos, what is your take, especially in the cybersecurity world? They seem very accepted. What is your take on Tattoos in terms of a company hiring somebody, a company looking at somebody based on their talent or their outward appearance? What's your take on the whole craze around tattoos and a little bit of alternate look for their employees?
Sure. So myself, I don't have tattoos. Let's start with that. But I think tattoos are like are a great way of self-expression, like clothing, like haircut, like hobbies, like anything, like art, whatever it would be. And I like people that find outlets to express themselves. So, like, I don't care if that's it's tattoos or anything other than that. That makes sense.
No, it makes sense, and I mean, it's just refreshing because, you know, I've had tattoos for a long time, and it was always kind of like, "Ooh, you're going to show that in public." But it seems that things are a lot more accepting these days, and outward expression of your personality is really kind of a cool thing. Okay. And the closing part of this podcast.
Closing time. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here.
So closing statements, Eyal, you know, if you want to plug something you're passionate about in terms of a charity or a organization, feel free. This is your chance to kind of, you know, put Eyal's mark on the podcast for today.
I'll just say Bionic is kind of my current life work, and I'm very excited of. And what gets me really excited every day is working with incredible people that do incredible things and drive huge processes and really transforming the way that security is done on apps in the cloud and much more. And we have talented technologists that are doing really the impossible in many senses. And we have incredible people in marketing and sales and like basically everywhere. And we're always looking for more. So please come join us at this work at our ship. I'd be really excited to work with you.
And maybe you can come on the podcast if you come to work for Bionic. You know, no promises, but if that gets you to come to work for us, I'm all in.
Yeah, for me, it only required like sending a message to Matt. So,
well, thank you very much for your time today, Eyal. I really appreciate you coming on.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
Thanks everybody for watching another great episode of Tattoos, Code, and Data Flows. Want to thank Eyal Mamo, CTO and co-founder of Bionic, for joining me. And take a look, like, follow, tag, listen, all the common social media terms. Thank you for watching.
Stand in line for this. It's always good.